Look, aesthetics tends to follow performance, but performance doesn't always follow aesthetics. In other words, if you train to move better, you're probably going to look better. If you train to look better, you won't always move better.
Discuss.
Yeah.
It's true.
It is. It's one of those things. It's like, you know, if you work out to improve mobility and function and control and strength and stamina, what typically follows that is a balanced, symmetrical, strong-looking physique. The other isn't always true. There's a lot of people that train hard for aesthetics and they sacrifice movement because in the pursuit of aesthetics. And then because they continue to sacrifice movement, they start to get injuries, they move poorly, and they slowly start to lose their aesthetics.
You can get hyper-focused on certain areas of your body and, you know, really bring them up. But once we keep, like, focusing on segmenting the body and not considering the whole, it's going to affect how everything performs together harmoniously. And so that's something that you always got to consider, that in terms of like when we're in a certain phase too long, especially in just focusing on aesthetics, it's how can I now apply these muscles that I've acquired, and how are they functioning as opposed to just how big and you know, veiny and vascular they look.
Yeah, you know what's funny is that when I was younger, I remember, obviously my goal was I wanted to get big, right? I wanted to build muscle. And then, and this is one piece of performance. Performance encompasses like everything that has to do with how you move and stuff. But I remember these power lifters, as I was a kid, I was a young kid, and they told me, you want to get big. They said, if you just get stronger, you're going to get bigger. Don't worry about anything else. Just get stronger right now, and you're going to build that muscle. And I did. I just focused. And it was like, God, it was that summer. I think I gained like 15 pounds of muscle because I listened to what they said. I said, okay, I'm just going to get strong and see what happens. And it blew away the results I had before where I was just focused on, you know, oh, I got to make myself look a particular way. You know, it made a big difference.
I don't know if I fully agree. I mean, you're implying that if you train like an athlete, you could look like an athlete.
Not necessarily. But
yeah,
let me put it this way. If you only train for performance, you're probably going to get a great deal of aesthetics. If you only train for aesthetics, think of all the people you know train for looks.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. That's why I don't agree with that. I think that there's a lot of kids, there's a lot of adults too that are training like athletes in hopes that they're going to look like athletes that never get to that place because their diet's so fucked and or their performance training sucks.
Well, okay.
Performance and athletics, yeah. I would agree with athletic training wise, but performance wise in terms of like, you know, compound lifts and considering more of a holistic, you know, functional type of strength training versus, because I do agree, people that try to do these explosive movements like athletes and everything, it doesn't always present, you know, the greatest physique, and also you get a lot of issues and problems in that direction because that's the extreme of, you know, what we're talking about. So but in terms of the opposite end of that, you know, I would consider if that's your entire focus is just to build up your aesthetics, like you may be diminishing a lot of the quality of your movement as a whole.
Yeah, that also, I agree with.
Yeah, and
so
also
I agree that training like to look a certain way more often than not leads to poor movement. I mean,
right.
a lot of bodybuilders, including myself, when I went through the competing years, some of my worst movement patterns came from training like a meathead because all I cared about was how I looked, not how I performed. And so you neglect a lot of the exercises and movements that help with that. And I wasn't doing it because it didn't give me the biggest bang for my buck when it came to building my shoulders or my chest. So I agree with the statement on that side. But
Okay, obviously, all things being equal, right? You can't have a crappy diet, train a particular way, expect to look better. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, all things being created equal, if you always are focused on looks, eventually, and I'm talking about longevity speaking, eventually you're going to lose your ability to do certain exercises. You develop aches and pains. Your movement quality will start to decline. And what follows that? Well, now you start to lose your aesthetics. Versus taking care of your ability to move, working on ranges of motion, doing exercises that have the most bang for the buck. That's what I mean by when I say performance. So, you know, I'm glad you said what you said, Justin, because it's not just aesthetics. When I'm saying performance, I mean it in the general holistic sense, right?
Yeah, and I think, too, you got to consider like objective and subjective type of feedback and how you're evaluating all of that, right? So, you know, there's a lot more objective type of data in terms of like, is my strength increasing? I could see that when I'm training more for performance. You know, versus like, am I gaining the kind of size and shape and, you know, like there's a lot more.
Well, the subjective. Well,
my point is this, there's a hell of a lot more people that are interested in what your professional athletes are doing and are trying to emulate what they're doing and that are failing and not getting the results they want than the people that are trying to emulate what bodybuilders are doing. There's a much smaller group of people that look up to bodybuilders and train that way than there are kids and people that look at professional athletes like Tom Brady and want to know, what is he doing diet-wise? What is he doing training-wise? I'm going to follow that.
Yeah, that's the wrong routine, obviously.
I agree with that.
You still got to train right for your body.
I know, but I'm just thinking that statement that you're saying is meant to be
a statement, and then we talk about it. So this is a good part of the conversation. It
can be true, but I think that you're missing a bigger portion of people who you're communicating to, because somebody hears performance and athletic training and they think train like an athlete. That's what people hear. They hear that. They don't think your guys' textbook definition of it. If you do, you're way off.
Okay, how do you train like an athlete? Do you copy another athlete's routine?
Most people, yes. No,
that's not what you do.
Well, that's my point, though.
Exactly.
That's my
point. And that's good. I'm glad you're saying that. You still have to train appropriately for your body. So this is all going to be very individual. So this doesn't mean follow someone else's routine that's inappropriate. You're going to follow a pro NFL player's routine, which is very specific to that individual, what they're trying to accomplish, their history, their body, their position on the field, like all that stuff. Well, that's wrong. But if you train yourself and your focus is movement and performance, you're more likely to get the longevity with your aesthetics than if it's only always on aesthetics. This is true for even diet. Though,
also, your influencers and your IG people and your magazine cover people, and like not just bodybuilders, but you know, all these like aesthetically good looking people, like they apply their routine, which is completely wrong.
Yes.
I mean, there's no doubt it's on both sides. But when you think of general population of people out there, sports, it has such a huge influence on kids and people and the way they train. That's why they always go get some athlete and they put them on the front cover or some movie star. Right. Yeah, and it sells, and it sells to millions, not a few hundred people. Yeah. You walk up to 10 people on the street randomly and ask them to name, you know, 5 bodybuilders, and they won't be able to tell you, but name 5 professional athletes you want to look like, and I bet you they can do that.
You're right. But I think it's a mistake to take performance and say it's how this professional athlete plays. That's what performance is. No, here's what I'm talking about. It's for performance for my grandma is, hey, grandma, let's see if we can get you to walk down the street versus just halfway up. Now you've improved your performance. Or my dad, hey, dad, I know your back hurts when you bend over, so to improve your performance, let's see if we can get you to bend over further.
Can you lift this without pain?
Yeah, can you lift? Like, that's what I mean by performance is your ability to perform better, move better, better ranges of motion, less pain, stronger, more connected. If you improve upon those metrics and keep that in focus, you're going to get longevity, and you're going to get, of course, all things being equal, you'll get a great deal of aesthetics. On the other side, if it's like, oh, I'm just going to focus on my weight, I'm just going to focus on how ripped I get or how I look in the mirror, which Justin made a great point, so subjective. If you have any type of body image issue, which most people do, you hold a little bit of water, hold, you know, less water, you know, lighting is different. I don't feel so good about myself today. Boy, is my opinion going to change drastically based on that. I mean, how many times have you had a client look at a picture of themselves 5 years prior and say, oh my God, I looked amazing, but I remember in that picture, I thought I looked so terrible. Mm-hmm. Versus performance, which is very objective. I was able to squat more weight, or I was able to do this with an inch deeper position with more control and stability, or my form looks so much better.
Well,
right?
We all agree that that's the most healthy approach towards fitness, period, is looking at your performance, how you perform in the gym, opposed to how you look.
Like, totally.
You know, paying attention to how you look. It's a hard one, right? Because you don't want to tell people, hey, you can't have a goal to look better, or you can't have a goal to get abs. You can't, like, you don't want to tell
people. Because that's the majority of what they're coming in there for.
Right.
Yeah.
I think the idea is to warn them where that potentially could lead if that is your main focus. And it's a much healthier approach to to look at movement over that. But I think performance for a lot of people just translates to athletic ability, and I think that athletes are the first thing that people look to. I think it's one of the biggest problems that are in the space is that you've got professional athletes that people aspire to be like, whether they like them as a person or they love their team and they like the way they look. And so they try and follow that and they think that this is performance. This is what Mind Pump meant when they said train for performance is to do that.
Yeah, you know, along those lines, the extremes are usually not the best, and I don't care what pursuit you're after, right? Yeah. So if I look at the extreme performance in terms of strength, I may look at, you know, a 350-pound power lifter. Yeah.
Strongman.
Yeah, or a strongman, right? And that is extreme performance, but I think in those extreme cases, you lose a lot, you know, of the other stuff, right? An extreme endurance runner or extreme muscle hypertrophy or any of that stuff. So I think this is in the context of overall, general, and for that individual. And if your goal, like I used to tell, this took me a long time to figure out, but when I got to the point where I remember, where I said, oh, you know, to my clients, I said, you know what? Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to the gym and practice these exercises. Just get better at these exercises, and then the results are going to follow. Don't worry about hammering your legs. Get better at squatting, for example. Don't worry about, you know, blasting your shoulders. I want you to get really good at overhead pressing. I want you to get really good, you know, at doing these suspension trainer Ws or whatever. And when they would do that and they'd go in with that focus, it was like everything else fell into place. Versus when they would go to the gym and say, oh, I got to look better. I want to hammer my quads or I want to hammer my glutes.
Which, well, it just seems that with that mentality, the goalpost just keeps moving. And like you said, that's why sometimes you'd like to take your client back and and show them, like, look how far you've got, you know? And like a lot of times they have to like visually see that because they just look at themselves currently at where they're at and where the flaws are. Is it's always like looking at their body in terms of where the flaws are, and it just never seems like it's achievable.
Yeah, it isn't, because they're not addressing the root cause. That's why the goalpost keeps moving, because it's really an insecurity issue. It's not really a 10-pound or 20-pound
issue. There's nothing that'll fill that hole.
That's right. Yeah. It's a bottomless pit, because you think, you look at yourself in the mirror and you go, oh, I hate the way I look. I just need to lose 30 pounds. You lose the 30 pounds and then you're in the boat you're saying right now. And that's because the problem wasn't the 30 pounds. You didn't address the real problem first, and so it'll just keep moving that goalpost.
You know, hey, if you enjoyed that clip, you can find the full episode here, or you can find other clips over here. And be sure to subscribe.